So namaste students, today we will discuss one of the very important chapter in biology, that is nothing but biomolecules. So here, what are these biomolecules? So as the name indicates, which are the chemical molecules which are found in the living organisms, and that is known to be the biomolecules. Okay, it is nothing but a biochemistry. So it is mainly found in the cell of an organism. Each and every organism's cell consisting of various chemicals. As you know that these chemicals can be divided into, there is organic substances as well as the inorganic substances, where these inorganic substances are acting as a raw material for the formation of organic substances. Okay, so now here, when we examine a plant tissue, animal tissue as well as a microbial waste. Okay, plant tissue, animal tissue and a microbial waste, which will be consisting of certain chemicals such as carbon, hydrogen, oxygen, so various chemicals that may be present. Now, we will compare it with the earth's crust. Okay, so we will compare with the earth crust. So, when we compare it with the earth crust, the presence of these substances may be same. Even the earth crust will be consisting of some of these substances, that is also having carbon, oxygen, hydrogen, all these substances even found in the earth crust. How so? Because after the death of the organism, of course everything goes to the soil. Okay, so that they may undergo a process of decomposition, whatever, so everything goes to the soil, that will be settled in the earth crust. But the difference is that, what is the difference between these earth crust? For example, we can take a human body. Okay, earth crust and a human body in case of these chemicals. So you can see this table. So this is a percentage weight of certain substances or certain elements found in the earth crust as well as in the human body. So here you can see the first foremost is a hydrogen, where hydrogen is about 0.14% in the earth crust and it is 0.5% in the human body. So that is, their percentage is high. Especially these substances and their percentage is slightly high in case of living organisms. Okay, then is about the carbon. Carbon is about 0.03 in the earth crust as well as 18.5% in the human body. Okay, and the oxygen, 46.6% in the earth crust and the 65% in the human body. And nitrogen in the atmosphere, earth crust, it is very little, because most of the nitrogen is in the gaseous form. Okay, so that is why it is very little in the earth crust, and in case of human body there are about 3.3%. Okay, so sulfur 0.03% in the earth crust and the human body 0.3%. Calcium 3.6% in the earth crust and it is around 1.5% in the human body. Magnesium 2.1% in the earth crust and around 0.1% in the human body. And the silicon, which is 27.7% in the earth crust and it is very negligible in case of a human body, because it is the toxic substance, that is why it is negligible in case of the human body. Okay, so this is regarding to the certain elements which are found in the earth crust as well as the human body. Though their presence may be similar, but their percentage varies from the earth crust as well as human body. Okay, so now that is regarding to these certain chemicals. Now, how to analyze the chemical composition? Okay, for example, you know that egg is consisting of more of what? Protein. Okay, egg yolk is consists of even the fat. So, all these you know. Now, you know the percentage in different food. Okay, starch is majorly consisting of carbohydrate. All those things you know, but how to analyze all those? How to analyze the chemical composition of a living tissue? So for that, first foremost, we have acid solubility test. In that, first we have acid solubility test. In case of acid solubility test, first a living tissue is taken. First foremost, a living tissue is taken. That living tissue may be a piece of vegetable or a piece of plant leaf or anything. It is a plant source or a piece of liver or any tissue. Okay, in case of animal source, and that is taken, and then it is grinded using a trichloroacetic acid. Okay, a chemical which is used here is a trichloroacetic acid to get a proper paste. Okay, using mortar and pestle. So what we use is a mortar as well as a pestle. After that, we will get a thick slurry. Okay, once it is grinded, then we will get a thick slurry, and this slurry must be filtered. So okay, so that slurry must be filtered in a cheese or a cotton cloth. Slurry must be filtered in a cheese or a cotton cloth so that after filtration we get two fractions. So there is a formation of two fractions. One is known to be the filtrate, the liquid fraction. That is nothing but the filtrate. Another one is a solid fraction, so that is retentate. Filtrate as well as the retentate. So whereas the filtrate is also known to be the acid soluble pool. Okay, filtrate is the acid soluble pool where the scientists have found out lot of organic substances in the acid soluble pool. Whereas retentate refers to the acid insoluble pool. Okay, retentate is the acid insoluble pool. So later on, once we get acid soluble and acid insoluble pool, so we can later check the presence of certain type of chemicals using various chemical tests. Okay, so we can also know the chemical formula, molecular structure, molecular weight, all these by using further test, especially what you do in the chemistry. Okay, so that is regarding to the acid solubility test, where in the acid solubility test a living tissue is taken, that is grinded in trichloroacetic acid using mortar and pestle, so that we get a thick slurry, and that slurry is filtered to get two fractions. One is the filtrate and one more is a retentate. Whereas the filtrate is also known as an acid soluble pool, where scientists have found out lot of organic substances in the acid soluble pool. Whereas the retentate, it is mainly an acid insoluble pool. So that is regarding to the acid solubility test. Now, if we want to get some of the inorganic elements or inorganic compounds, if we want only inorganic elements or inorganic compounds, then we can go for ash analysis. Okay, then we can go for ash analysis. In the ash analysis, again a small tissue is taken, either a plant basis or an animal basis. Okay, small tissue is taken, either a plant basis as well as an animal basis, and it is weighed. Okay, so that tissue is weighed, that weight is known to be the wet weight. It is also consisting of moisture or water content. So that is nothing but a wet weight. So now, then it is dried. Okay, after that it is dried to get the dry weight. So that all the water content will be evaporated. Okay, then we will get a dry weight. So next what happens? This particular tissue that will be burnt to oxidize all the carbon compounds into a gaseous form. Okay, so this tissue, dried tissue, is burnt to oxidize all the carbon compounds to the gaseous form. What we get now is the ash. Okay, after oxidizing, after burning, what we get is the ash. It is mainly consisting of some of the inorganic substances. So this ash, which can further examined, okay, so this ash can be further examined for the various chemical compounds. So for example, if it is consisting of inorganic elements, the elements such as calcium, magnesium, okay, all those are the inorganic elements, or there may be presence presence of some of the inorganic compounds such as sulfate, phosphate, sodium chloride. All these are the inorganic compounds which are mainly found in these. Okay, so this test is mainly done to know the inorganic elements or compounds which are found in a living tissue. Okay, so that is regarding to the ash analysis. So these are also seen in the acid soluble pool. Okay, they are also seen in the acid soluble pool, especially these inorganic elements or compounds, they are also seen in the acid soluble pool. So that is regarding to this. Now finally, what we can conclude is, what are these biomolecules? So the biomolecules are the all carbon containing compounds which are found in the living organisms. All the carbon containing compounds which are found in the living organisms are known to be the biomolecules. The chemicals which are found in the living organisms are found to be the biomolecules. As you know that it can be distinguished into inorganic substances as well as the organic substances. Okay, inorganic and organic substances. Now these can also be divided into biomicromolecules. So there is a presence of biomicromolecules as well as the biomacromolecules. Biomicromolecules and the biomacromolecules. Biomicromolecules are the substances which are mainly consisting of a molecular weight which are less than the 1000 atom. Okay, so they have less molecular weight, they are known to be the biomicromolecules. More molecular weight, they are known to be the biomacromolecules. So there is biomicro as well as the biomacromolecules. Okay, so all those we discuss in the topic known as a biomacromolecules. Next we will continue with the some of the biomicromolecules, starting with the amino acids. Okay, so regarding to the, as I told, biomicro as well as the biomacromolecules, whereas biomicromolecules are having a molecular weight which ranges between 18 to 800 Dalton. Okay, so their molecular weight ranges between the 18 to 800 Dalton. Whereas regarding to the biomacromolecules, they are mainly found in the acid insoluble fraction. Okay, so they are seen in the acid insoluble fraction, but their molecular weight is more than the 1000 Dalton. So here we have an exception, that is a lipid. So lipid is consisting of a molecular weight that is 800 Dalton. Based on its molecular weight, which can be considered under a biomicromolecule, but it is not considered as a biomicromolecule, it is considered as a biomacromolecule. Why? Because these are mainly found in the acid insoluble fraction. Okay, so these lipids are mainly found in the acid insoluble fraction, so that is why it is considered to be the biomacromolecule. Whereas biomicromolecules, they are mainly consisting of a molecular weight which ranges between 18 to 800 Daltons. Okay, so next we will see one of the biomicromolecule. It is nothing but amino acids. Okay, amino acids are the biomicromolecules. So these amino acids are very important for the formation of protein. There are about 20 types of amino acids involved in the production of proteins, right? So here, amino acids are considered to be the building blocks for the formation of proteins, whereas the proteins are our body building blocks. They are considered to be the building blocks of our body, so that is nothing but the proteins. So what are these amino acids? So amino acids are the organic compounds. So they are mainly an organic compound. Okay, so they are mainly an organic compound containing a amino group NH2. It contains the amino group, that is NH2, as well as the carboxyl group, acidic group, nothing but the carboxyl group, and a variable group. R group is the variable group. All these are carbon. So this carbon is nothing but the alpha carbon.
Okay, amino acids are the organic compounds containing a amino group and an acidic group, carboxyl group, as a substituents on the same carbon, and that is known to be the alpha carbon. Other than these, there is also presence of H as well as the R group. R group, as I told, there are about 20 amino acids. So this R group varies for the different types of amino acids. Okay, so there will be a different type of amino acid for the different types of amino acid based on the R group. Okay, for example, the R group is H. In case of a type of amino acid known as a glycine, in case of glycine, R group is H. It is the simplest form of amino acid. Okay, so in case of alanine, it is a CH3, methyl group. Okay, alanine, it is a CH3. And in case of serine, there is an amino acid known as serine, where the R group is nothing but CH2OH. R group is a CH2OH. Okay, simple amino acid is a glycine consisting of H as a R group. Okay, in case of alanine, it is CH3. In case of serine, it is CH2OH. So there are about 20 amino acids. Now, these 20 amino acids are classified into essential amino acid as well as the non-essential amino acids. Okay, so these 20 amino acids are classified into essential amino acids as well as the non-essential amino acids. What are these essential and non-essential amino acids? Essential amino acids are the ones which are not synthesized in our body. Okay, which are not synthesized in the body, but they are necessary for our body. That's why we will take it through food. Okay, so that is required by the body, but body is not producing it. That's why we will take it through diet. That is essential amino acids. Whereas non-essential amino acids, wherein the case of non-essential amino acids, those are the amino acids which are synthesized in our body. That is why we need not take it through food. Okay, non-essential amino acids are synthesized in our body. That is why we need not to take it through food. So that is regarding to the essential as well as the non-essential amino acids. There are about 10 essential amino acids and 10 non-essential amino acids. Total 20 amino acids which are involved in the production of proteins. Right. Next. The physical property or the chemical nature, everything depends on the amino as well as the carboxyl group. Okay, their physical property, their chemical nature, everything depends on the amino as well as the carboxyl group. Where amino acids are also acts as amphoteric substances. They also as amphoteric substances. What do you mean by amphoteric substances? Amphoteric substances refers to the okay, so those are the some chemicals which act as both acid as well as the base. Amphoteric substances which act as both acid as well as the base. Next, based on the number of carboxyl as well as the amino group. Okay, so based on the number of carboxyl and amino group, amino acids are classified into different types. So for example, acidic amino acids consisting of more of acid group. Okay, so we have acidic amino acids such as glutamic acid, aspartic acid. Okay, so they are comes under acidic amino acids. Next is about the basic amino acids, more base. Okay, basic amino acid, for example, lysine. Neutral amino acid, where in case of neutral amino acid, that is almost equal, so that is a valine. Whereas there is also one more type that is known to be the aromatic amino acids. What are these aromatic amino acids, which are consisting of some aroma? Okay, so aromatic amino acid includes tyrosine, phenylalanine as well as tryptophan. This is very important for your exam point of view. Examples can be asked. See, remember in your theory, they did not mention the types of amino acids. The 20 types of amino acids, that is not required for your theory. That is only required for your competitive exam. So that we'll discuss in the competitive classes. Okay. So here 20 types of amino acids are there based on the presence of amino and carboxyl group. They are further classified into acidic amino acid, for example, glutamic acid. Basic amino acid, for example, lysine. Neutral amino acid, for example, valine. Aromatic amino acid includes the tyrosine, phenylalanine as well as the tryptophan. So those are the aromatic amino acids. There is one more concept here, that is the Zwitter ionic form. So what is this Zwitter ionic form? So Zwitter ionic form refers to the, there will be a ionization nature. There will be a ionization of amino group and carboxyl group. Okay, transfer of groups. So there is a ionization of amino group as well as the carboxyl group. When it is kept in a different pH. When an amino acid, when it is kept in a different pH than its actual pH. Okay, so pH, as you know that we have a pH ranges from the 0 to 14. So we have acidic pH, neutral pH as well as the basic pH. So when an amino acid's pH is altered, when the amino acid kept in some other pH solution, then what happens? There will be a ionization of carboxyl group as well as the amino group. Okay, ionization of carboxyl group and amino group leading to transfer of this H towards this. So there is NH3 plus as well as the COO minus. So that is nothing but property of ionization, which is mainly seen in the case of this. Okay, so now here you can see that there is COO minus, but it is NH2. These are considered to be the unstable stages. They are the intermediate and they are unstable, and this is a reversible reaction. But here the B form is known to be the Zwitter ionic form. So this is the Zwitter ionic form. So that is regarding to the Zwitter ionic form. What is Zwitter ionic form? There is ionization of amino group as well as the carboxyl group. The structure of amino acids changes. The structure of amino acids changes due to the ionization of amino group and carboxyl group when it is kept in a different pH. And that is known to be the Zwitter ionic form. Okay, so this is regarding to the amino acids, where amino acids are the organic compounds containing the amino group, carboxyl group and the variable R group. So this variable R group changes for different types of amino acids. There are about 20 different kinds of amino acids which are involved in the synthesis of proteins. So example for these, glycine, where H instead of R group, CH3 is alanine, CH2OH is nothing but 7. Okay. So next, they are also known as a substituted methanes. Why they are known as substituted methanes? Mainly because there is a presence of 4 valency groups. They are known as a substituted methanes because there is a presence of 4 valency groups. Okay, so R group, NH2, COH as well as the H. So that is why it is known to be the substituted methanes. Okay, so next, these amino acids can be classified into acidic amino acid, basic amino acid, neutral amino acid as well as the aromatic amino acid. And there is also an important concept, that is Zwitter ionic form. So this is regarding to the amino acids. In the next session, we will discuss about the lipids.